Father, a new year. Lord, we just pray that we learn from the past. We look forward to the future. And Lord, I just pray that you do mighty things in our lives and in our church this coming year, Lord. I just pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Us. There's no right nor magic word. Only by the work of Jesus can salvation be secured. It is finished, he has done it. Let your weary heart rejoice. Our redemption is accomplished. Raise a shout with dragon voice. And go bravely into battle, knowing he has won the war. It is finished, lift your head and weep no more. There's no sacrifice to offer, there's no penance to complete. Freely drink of living water, without money, come and feast. It is finished, he has done it, let your weary heart rejoice. Our redemption is accomplished, raise a shout with ragged voice. And go bravely into battle, knowing he has won the war. It is finished, lift your head and let every sinner rejoice. Hear the dying victor's cry, raise up your voice, sing it out through earth and sky. It is finished, he has done it. Let your weary heart rejoice. Our redemption is accomplished. Raise a shout with ragged voice. And go bravely into battle, knowing he has won the war. It is finished, lift your head and weep no more.
Happy New Year. A new year. What does a new year mean? It's a new year. What does that mean to you? Are you older now? Are you going to get older this coming year? One of the things as adult, everybody's focused on everywhere but me. What are you guys thinking? Adults have a thing called New Year's resolutions. What is a New Year's resolution? Do you know? Something you want to do this coming year, okay? Does anyone have a New Year's resolution? How about adults? Anyone have a New Year's resolution? Not to have any. One of my favorite quotes is, aim at nothing and you will surely hit it. So I'm like, okay, we need something. So here's mine. Every year I always want to lose weight because I'm too heavy for my height. So this year, my New Year's resolution is to grow a little bit. That'll take care of that, right? I think. But you know, I was thinking, like, what do I want to do this next year? I really only have one thing that I need to do, and I need to work on a house and try to get it fixed. But other than that, I really don't have anything. We've got some plans for the youth coming up and what we're going to do. But I was thinking, Patty and I were having an interesting discussion on the way to Tucson. We just went down and saw my grandkids and my son and his wife. But the question was, what can you remember about grade school? And I got to thinking, it's like, I don't remember a whole lot about grade school. I remember I wet my pants in third grade a couple of times. Okay, so that was and it's like, Patty's like, I don't really remember anything about grade school because it was, everything was kind of normal that went through there. But I was thinking, let's just hope for a normal year. Okay, that'll be a good thing to happen. But here's what, even in a normal year, what should we hope for? What should we try for? And this is in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. And people were talking, you know, they were kind of arguing about, you know, what they should do and what they shouldn't do. And Paul addresses it, and he says in 31, he says, I want you, so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. And so I was thinking about this year. I really don't have any big plans, but if every day I can live it to bring glory to God, that'll be a successful year. So I want to encourage you. What are you going to do this year? Bring praise and glory to God. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you for today. And Father, I just pray for this coming year, Lord. We don't know what it holds, but you do. And Father, I just pray that everything that we do, I pray that we bring glory to you. For its name in Jesus we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Ted. If you can turn with me to begin, Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1. This is found on page 972 if you're following along in a foyer Bible. Paul was really addressing a bunch of Jews that had crept into the early church with this message that said, sure, believe in Jesus. Absolutely believe in Jesus. But you also need to become a Jew. Which for men, that means you need to be circumcised. We don't care how old you are. And you need to adopt our diet. You need to adopt our ceremonial calendar. And Paul had quite a bit to say about that. And this is what he said in verses 6 through 9. He says, I am astonished that you're so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ. And you're turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another one, but there's some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. As we said it before, so now I say it again. If anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you received, let him be accursed. He said it twice. If anybody preaches a different gospel, let him be cursed. Now, what does he mean by let him be accursed? Some of your translations might say, let him be anathema. If you look up some kind of a Bible dictionary, that will say, let him be set aside, let him be devoted to destruction. If anybody teaches you, distorts the gospel message, and tries to get you to believe something that's going to lead you astray, let him be devoted to destruction. This is the Apostle Paul we're talking about here. The guy who could be arguably be the biggest evangelist in the early church aside from Jesus Christ himself. He was saying, if there's anybody who would teach a message that would lead you astray, if it were up to me, that guy would go to hell right now. Apparently, this is a pretty big issue for him. And this sounds a little foreign to us. And I fall in this category too, because I'm an American too, but in our culture, truth is not the thing that we uphold more than anything else. It's tolerance. As long as we can find some kind of a bare minimum of agreement, so at least we can all get along. That is the value that we really uphold in our culture. And this is not a new thing. You can't say, well, that's the problem with millennials today. The ones before me. That's the problem with Xers today, or that's the problem with the boomers today. You know, right, that all the way back in the days of World War II, you have Dietrich Bonhoeffer coming from Germany, from Hitler's Germany, coming over to America, getting into theological discussions with a bunch of American pastors and American Christians and American churches, and he was devastated all the way back then. You guys don't care anything about the truth. All you want to do is get along. You don't want to talk about any of the real issues. All you want to do is be on the same team. So we've been dealing with this for a very long time, but apparently the Apostle Paul thought this was a big deal. You know, we've been talking about for a while, what is First Baptist all about? What's our mission statement that drives us, that drives our activities, drives our energy, drives our finances, drives our attention? What are we giving ourselves to? When we ask you to be a part of First Baptist Church, what are we asking you to be a part of? And it is so much more than just being a part of coming on Sunday mornings and listening to Mike lead us in music and listening to what Fred has to say about the Bible today. Now, there are people that we are so excited are listening to us on Facebook, but many people are listening to like 10 different church services on Facebook. Is that all the church is? Is it just watching some different church program on Facebook or on the TV? No, there's more than that. What are we supposed to be all about? And that's what we've been talking about. If you can, look on the screen. Here is our mission statement of what's been driving us. We want to connect with God and his family. One of the things that we see on Facebook is even though the people are watching on Sundays, they're able to connect in other ways. Even if they can't be with us on Sunday morning, they're still finding ways to have Christian fellowship, and they're still finding ways to serve. So that's because it's very important to us. We want to connect with God and his family. We want to grow in God's word. We want to serve God by serving others. And this is the last one we're talking about today. We want to share God's message. What does God want everybody to know that he has put into our hands to share? What is he desperate that they understand so that they do not fall under his curse? So that they can know what the true gospel is in this crazy culture that has so many different forms of it. What is it that we need to know, that we must know in order to be saved, and that we're sharing with other people so that they can be saved too? We're going to talk about 3 points here, and here's your number one if you're taking notes. What is God's message? To be saved, we have to have an accurate belief about Jesus. To be saved, we have to have an accurate belief about Jesus. And I did pick my terminology somewhat carefully in the fact I did not say to be saved, we have to believe in Jesus. Because we live in a culture where Jesus has been around for a while. He's been a topic of conversation for a while. And there are so many different ideas of who this guy is. and they're not all right, and they won't all bring us to salvation. To be saved, you have to have an accurate belief about Jesus. You know, right, that Muslims have a lot of belief about Jesus. They love Jesus. He is a great prophet. He is one of the greatest prophets, and they hold him to high esteem. As a matter of fact, I've never read it, but I understand that Jesus is mentioned more times in their holy scripture than Muhammad is. The Muslims love Jesus. They know the name of Jesus. They would say they believe there was a man named Jesus. But they don't have an accurate understanding of Jesus, and so therefore their message is not a message of salvation. Well, what do we have to believe about Jesus then? Well, what does the Bible say about Jesus? Fred, how much time do we have? You're right. There's a long list of what we can, if we just wanted to do a mini series on who is Jesus really, that would take weeks. Today, it's just one point, so I just want to focus in on one of them. And I think it's probably the biggest issue that we struggle with as our culture is Jesus is God the Son. And I worded that intentionally too. He's not just the Son of God. Because there's lots of different ways that you can say somebody is the Son of God. You know, there's two different places in the Old Testament where angels are called the Son of God, sons of God. And Jesus isn't just another angel. He is God the Son himself. And turn with me to John chapter 8 to see how important this concept is to hang on to for the sake of the gospel. John chapter 8. Verses 21 through 29. This is found on page 894 if you're following along in your foyer Bible. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, "If you abide in my word, you're truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We're offspring of Abraham, and we've never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you'll become free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. For if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you're on the offspring of Abraham, yet you seek to kill me because my word finds no place in you. I speak of what I've seen with my father, and you do what you've heard from your father." And they answered him, "Abraham is our father." Jesus said to them, "If you're Abraham's children, you would be doing the works Abraham did. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. This is not what Abraham did. You're doing the works your father did." They said to him, "We were not born of sexual immorality. We have one Father, even God." Jesus said to them, "If God were your Father, you would love me, for I came from God and I'm here. I came not of my own accord, but he sent me. Why do you not understand what I say? It's because you cannot bear to hear my word. You're of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, and he does not stand in the truth because there's no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he's a liar and the father of lies. But because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Which one of you convicts me of sin? If I tell you the truth, why do you not believe me? Whoever is of God hears the words of God. The reason why you do not hear them is you're not of God." The Jews answered him, "Are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and have a demon?" At the beginning of this passage, it said they believed in him. I guess they changed their mind. Jesus answered, "I do not have a demon, but I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. Yet I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it. He is the judge. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death." The Jews said to him, "Now we know you have a demon. Abraham died, as did the prophets. Yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died? And the prophets died. Who do you make yourself out to be?" Jesus answered, "If I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say he is our God. But you've not known him. I know him. If I were to say that I did not know him, I would be a liar like you, but I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. So the Jews said to him, you're not yet 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham? Jesus said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. So they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. You're very patient. You're like, he didn't read the right verses at all. It's like, I'm not reading the one that I, but wasn't that an interesting passage? Let's go back to what I actually wanted to read. Verse 21. So he said to them again, I'm going away, and you'll seek me, and you'll die in your sin. Where I'm going, you cannot come. So the Jews said, will he kill himself? Since he says, where I'm going, you cannot come. He said to them, you're from below, I'm from above. You're of this world, I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. They said to him, who are you? And Jesus said to them, just what I've been telling you from the beginning. I have much to say about you and much to judge, but he who sent me is true, and I declare to the world what I've heard from him. They didn't understand that he had been speaking to them about the Father. So Jesus said to them, when you've lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he. And I do nothing on my own authority, but I speak just as my Father taught me. And he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to him. As he was saying these things, many did believe in him. What did he say? He said twice. And then three times, if you count the passage I wasn't planning on reading, I am he. Furthermore, if you do not believe that I am he, you will die in your sin. Which means you will not be saved. You are not going to heaven. You are not my kid if you do not believe I am he. Now, if you're reading along in the New International Version, I love the New International Version. I read it for most of my life. But this is definitely one of the times where I think they did a little bit of an injustice in their translation. It's not totally wrong. It's just not as accurate as it could be. But you might have read, unless you believe that I am who I say I am. That's okay. But really, in Jesus' language, what he said is, ego I me, I am he. And he was deliberately labeling himself in the way that God labels himself in one of the most famous passages in Jewish theology, Isaiah chapter 40 through chapter 55. We're not going to read all those chapters this morning. And we are actually, when we go back into Isaiah next week, that's where we're picking up in our study. It's one of my favorite sections of Isaiah because in it, God takes on all the idolatry of Israel. He starts picking on the gods that they've been giving themselves to and showing how he's superior. And he keeps referring to himself as I am he. And then he makes these amazing claims about himself. Let's just look at some of them on the screen. You don't have to look them up with me, because I'd probably read the wrong ones anyway. This is what God says about himself in these chapters. He is eternal. You don't have to write all these down. This is for free. He is eternal and the determiner of world history. This is what he says. Who has done this and carried it through? Calling forth the generations from the beginning. I, the Lord, with the first of them and with the last. I am he. Now, as we read all these, remember, this is what Jesus is claiming for himself by giving himself the same title. He's saying, Jesus was saying, I am eternal, and I am the determiner of world history. And if you don't believe that, you're going to die in your sins. Here's the next one. He is the only God and the only Savior. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I've chosen, so that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me, no God was formed, nor will there be one after me. I am the Lord, and apart from me, there is no Savior. So Jesus could say that about himself. Here's the next one. He is the all-powerful one that no one can thwart. Yes, and from ancient days, I am he. No one can deliver out of my hand. When I act, who can reverse it? If you're a mature Christian, that verse gives you so much hope and comfort. If you're still struggling with what this Christianity thing is all about, that's one of the most offensive verses in the Bible to you, because you don't like the idea that God has a plan that nobody can thwart. Because what does that do to our own will and our own decisions? We can't thwart God. He says, no, you can't, because I am he. And basically, Jesus says the same thing. Here's the next one. He is the one who blots out our sins for his own sake. I am one who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. Next one. He is the one who creates us, carries us, and saves us, even to your old age and gray hairs. I am he. I am he who will sustain you. I've made you. I will carry you. I will sustain you. I will rescue you. He is the creator of the universe. I am he. I am the first. I am the last. My own hand laid the foundations of the earth, and my right hand spread out the heavens. When I summon them, they all stand up together. So Jesus was saying, here, I'm the one that all the angels are praising. I'm the one that the sun, moon, and the stars, they just stop to look at my glory. I am he. Now, when he says that phrase about himself, that title for himself, and then says, furthermore, you're not going to heaven unless you believe this, he's saying quite a mouthful, isn't he? The idea that Jesus can be the greatest prophet and not be God the Son is just smacked in the head. Because no other prophet could say this kind of stuff about himself and not be a complete lunatic. The only way Jesus can be good is if he really is God the Son. Now, here's where I know it's really confusing. Because this is another heresy that's come out, propagated by names like T.D. Jakes. And this one kills me, Phillips, Craig, and Dean, because I love their songs, but they believe this, and so I hold it against them. They believe that God the Father and Jesus are the same person. And that is not what we believe. I mean, you can't just throw out the rest of the Bible and what it says about the Trinity because Jesus called himself, I am he. There is one God, one being, one divine eternal substance of a being, but it's manifested in three persons. And I know that's confusing. That's why other false religions, they pick on us with this, because they know we don't really understand it either. We don't really get it. We just believe it to be true because that's the way the Bible describes it. If you read the rest of John 8, there's very little I did not read to you. You read the whole chapter, you would see, obviously, there's more than one person in this Godhead thing. Because Jesus says things like, my Father sent me. My Father taught me. My Father is with me. I obey my Father. If Jesus were God the Father, that's just nonsense all of a sudden. Jesus was basically telling everybody, I sent myself. I taught myself. I keep myself company because, after all, nobody else likes me. And I obey myself. That's not what he was saying. He's saying, I have a Father who I'm in love dearly. And I'm doing everything that he told me. So obviously, there's more than one person. And you read the whole Bible, there's three. But there's only one God. One being having one substance to where they all share the same character. They're all worthy of worship. They all have the same plan. They're all working according to the same will. But there are three persons. You know, as Protestant church, that's really not into high churchy. We don't like liturgy. One of the ways that we really cheat ourselves is that we don't hang on to these statements of our past and church history, that the church came to clarify our beliefs so that we can help guard ourselves against all the craziness that creeps in the form of false doctrine. And one of those statements of beliefs that was absolutely amazing was the Athanasian Creed. It was called the Athanasian Creed because they attributed it to some black bishop named Athanasius. And we've discovered now he probably was not the guy who wrote this, but he would have really liked it. Because in his day, this black bishop, he pretty much stood up against the Roman emperor and the entire Roman empire, and he was thrown into exile because he was one of the only voices speaking out saying, do not get rid of the Trinity. You have to have the Trinity. It's not enough to mess with this thing. That's not a true picture of God. You got to hang on to this. And the church was really trying to pervert it during his day. But this was the Athanasian Creed that I just want to read with you. You'll have it on the screen, so follow along while I read this to you. It says, we worship one God in Trinity and the Trinity in unity, neither blending their persons nor dividing their essence. For the person of the Father is a distinct person. The person of the Son is another, and that of the Holy Spirit still another. But the divinity of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is one. Their glory is equal. Their majesty is co-eternal. What quality the Father has, the Son has, and the Holy Spirit has. The Father is uncreated. The Son is uncreated. The Holy Spirit is uncreated. The Father is immeasurable. The Son is immeasurable. The Holy Spirit is immeasurable. The Father is eternal. The Son is eternal. The Holy Spirit is eternal. And yet there are not three eternal beings. There is but one eternal being. So too, there are not three uncreated or immeasurable beings. There is but one uncreated and immeasurable being. Similarly, the Father is almighty. The Son is almighty. The Holy Spirit is almighty. And there are not three almighty beings, there is but one almighty being. Thus, the Father is God, the Son is God, the Holy Spirit is God. Yet there are not three gods, there is but one God. Thus, the Father is Lord, the Son is Lord, the Holy Spirit is Lord. Yet there are not three lords, there is but one Lord. Just as Christian truth compels us to confess each person individually as both God and Lord, so the Christian religion forbids us to say that there are three gods or three lords. The Father was neither made nor created nor begotten from anyone. The Son was neither made nor created. He was begotten from the Father alone. The Holy Spirit was neither made nor created nor begotten. He proceeds from the Father and the Son. Accordingly, there is one Father, not three fathers. There's one Son, not three sons. There's one Holy Spirit, not three Holy Spirits. Nothing in this Trinity is before or after the other one. Nothing is greater or smaller. In their entirety, the three persons are co-eternal and co-equal with each other. So in everything, as was said earlier, we must worship their Trinity in their unity, and their unity in their Trinity. You know, they used to make kids memorize this. Well, we're so much smarter than that. We don't need to memorize this kind of stuff anymore. No, we're dumber. We really are. And what kills me is we're intentionally dumber. Some of you are begging me, please stop talking about this because nobody cares in your mind. If you could say what you're really thinking, that's what you would tell me. We don't care about the Trinity. We don't care about all this Athanasian Creed stuff. Tell me something that will actually matter for my life tomorrow. And why do we have so many false religions stealing us out of the churches today is because we don't even talk about this stuff. Now, it's a great description. It's a lousy explanation. Do you know why it's a lousy explanation for the Trinity? Because there is no good explanation for the Trinity. It is nothing like anything else that we have in reality. Oh, Fred, no, come on, it's easy. You have an egg. or you have water. Sometimes it can be ice. Sometimes it can be steam. Sometimes it can be a liquid. Or it's kind of like the Father and the Son and the husband. He's all one person but three different functions. All of those break down. maybe they can help begin the conversation, but none of those fully grasp and encapsulate what the Bible describes in the Trinity. It doesn't explain it because there is no explanation. The person says, oh, the Trinity is easy. Obviously, they haven't really thought about it. But it was a great summary of what the Bible says about the Trinity. And even if you're never going to totally get the Trinity, which I think for all eternity, we're going to be like, okay, I'm almost there. God, help me one more time. Even if you're not going to ever grasp it because it's always so much beyond us, here's what you got to know from an understanding of the Trinity is Jesus is every bit as much God as his Father is. The Holy Spirit is every bit as much God as God the Father and God the Son is. And if you try to demote any of them to anything less than God, or you try to elevate anybody to where they can share in the ingredient that makes God, God. I mean, God feels like he's set apart because of this godness. Even if we're made in his image, that doesn't mean we became God. That just means we're a reflection of him. We're a reminder of him. We point to him. But nobody is like him in his godness, except those three persons of the Trinity, Jesus included. So if you try to elevate anybody else, or you try to demote any of the three, you just committed idolatry and you changed who Jesus is. And that is not the gospel. Jesus said, if you do not believe, I'm not just the Son of God, if you do not believe I'm God the Son, you will die in your sins. We have to have an accurate belief about who Jesus is. I too have friends. I too have family members that are wonderful people. But because they're part of a church that has messed this up, and because they believe it, they're not going to heaven unless they repent. Unless you believe I am he, you will die in your sins. Here's the second thing we got to know and we got to be talking about. To be saved, we have to have an accurate belief about ourselves. You remember the story of the garden? Remember why that forbidden fruit was called the tree of knowledge of good and evil? Why would that be such a bad thing? Doesn't God want us to know the difference between good and evil? I mean, isn't that part of what it means to be like God, knowing the difference between good and evil? Absolutely. That's why you're created. That's what set us apart from everything in the animal kingdom. Animals don't have a sense of morality, as in, I feel like peeing on your rug is immoral for me to do. No, the reason they don't pee on the rug is because the last time they did, you got all mad and threw them outside. They don't have the same sense of morality we do. We as humans, we are like God, and so we are supposed to know the difference between good and evil. It's just that God intended for them to learn the difference between good and evil by faith, by believing him and what he defined as good and evil. And what he defined as good and evil is, don't eat from that tree. If you didn't eat from the tree, that would be good. If you do eat from the tree, that's evil. And Adam and Eve, what did they do? We want to know the difference between good and evil, God, but we don't want to do it by faith, by believing in your definition. We want to come up with our own definition. We want to define for ourselves what's good and evil, and we think that tree is good for food. It's pleasing to our eye. It would give us wisdom. So we want to eat it. And won't be good our way. And God said, you will surely die. And unfortunately, the human condition is we've been doing the same thing ever since. No, we want so bad to be good. Most people I know, they want so bad to be good. They'll participate in charity events. They'll give money to poor people. They'll be good neighbors. They'll be kind because they want to be good, but they want to be good according to their own definition and not by living by faith. And unfortunately, that is not the quality that Jesus is looking for in having a relationship with him that could actually save them. What he sees is that's just eating the fruit all over again. Do you remember the story of two men that were worshiping in the temple that Jesus told? Let's go ahead and read it together. This is in Luke chapter 18. Luke chapter 18, verses 9 through 14. He also told this parable to some who were trusting in themselves that they were righteous, and they treated others with contempt. So two men went up into the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed this way: God, I thank you I'm not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector over here. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven. He beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Jesus said only one of the guys went home justified before God that day. Justified being, meaning declared not guilty, declared good. Thank you. To be saved, we have to have an accurate belief about ourselves. Only one guy went home that way and not the other one. Why? Because the Pharisee, he got up there and he said, God, look at me. I'm a good guy. And he had his own definition of what he thought made him good. Sure, he was a hypocrite. Sure, he was judgmental. Sure, he was put it upon himself to feel like he was amazing and he was arrogant. But he didn't care about that. What made him good in his eyes was, I fast twice a week and I'm a tither. Therefore, I'm amazing. And God's like, you know, that's just eating the fruit. You're defining for yourself what's good. You're not living by faith in what I say is good. What you need to be is like this guy over here. He wasn't even looking up into heaven. He was beating his breast, saying, God, have mercy on me. And in the original language, he called himself the sinner. God, there's nobody in this building that's worse than me. I am the sinner. Have mercy on me. Because if you do, then I know I'll be okay. That's what God's looking for. He's not looking for the people that feel like they finally got this Christian life down. No, they're living according to their own merit, and they're feeling like they're doing pretty well. And the way that they feel like they're doing pretty well is they have their own definition of what's good, and after all, they're comparing themselves to all these other people, and at least they look better than them. So God, you and I, we're in. And God's like, that's eating the fruit again. I hated that. What I want is you to finally come to me and say, I'm so sorry. Have mercy on me. I'm not righteous. I'm the sinner. Forgive me. Give me your righteousness, and then I know I'll be okay. To be saved, people not only have to have an accurate understanding of Jesus, they also have to have an accurate understanding of themselves. They actually need to know they need to be saved. Jesus isn't some kind of a self-help program. Jesus isn't something that just makes you feel better about yourself. Jesus is not something that can just make you less scared of the future. He is the Savior to rescue us, from our sin that keeps weighing us down and ripping our lives apart. And until we get that, until we come to Him under those definitions, we don't really understand what the gospel is. Here's the last one. What is God's message? Believing in Jesus means stepping onto the path towards trusting Him completely. Now, I worded that one carefully, too. I did not say believing in Jesus means trusting Him completely. You know why? Because I'm still struggling with that. I've been a Christian for a very, very long time. I became a Christian when I was 6 years old. I was just a little bit older than Nico. Or is Nico, how old are you? What's that? Oh, I was 1 year younger than you. That's how old I was when I became a Christian. I've been believing it ever since. And I'm still struggling with trusting in Jesus completely. Oh, I tithe, showing that I'm growing in my ability to trust him with my finances, but I still get worried about what that guy's doing in the White House. Oh, I love my family, pray for my family, have great hopes for my family, but I still worry about what my kids are going to do when they leave the protection of my home. Oh, I love you as my church. I love what we're doing as a church. I'm enjoying the journey, but it freaks me out what's going to happen in 5 or 10 years when the torch starts getting passed and all the leadership roles and in all the giving responsibilities and all the service opportunities. What's going to happen in 10 years? I just really struggle with trusting God completely. Well, thankfully, I'm still saved. To be saved, you don't have to trust Jesus completely. You have to get on the path where you say, Jesus, I want to start learning how to trust you completely. I'm turning away from my sin. I'm totally following you. There's a very old movie, but it's a classic. Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. Anybody see that movie? There's a couple preacher points in that movie that I just couldn't help. Even when I was in college thinking about that movie, it's like, oh, that would preach. And I wasn't even planning on being a preacher. But the movie stuck with me. And it's the last scene, or one of the last scenes, before they ride out into the sunset, where Indiana Jones, you know, he's been looking for the Holy Grail for the whole movie. And at the end, there it is. It's like teetering on this ledge inside of this chasm. And he's hanging on to his dad's hand with one hand. And he's trying to reach that Holy Grail with the other hand. He's like fingering it. He's like moving it around. And he can almost reach it. And you can see his hands, his sweaty hands slipping out of his dad's grip. And it's like right before he slips out all the way. Because he just wants it so bad. I mean, this is what he's been looking for 2.5 hours now. And this is just going to make his whole life so much better. This is what his life is all about. But right before his dad slips his grip, and Indy just plunges into the bottomless chasm below to his certain death, his dad says, Indiana. And Indiana looks up at his dad, and he says, let it go. Indiana finally grabs onto his dad's hands with both hands, and his dad lifts him up, and Indiana leaves the Holy Grail behind. It wasn't a happy ending to where somehow the earth shifted and the Holy Grail flung up out of the chasm. Indiana got it anyway. He left it behind. The Holy Grail plummets down to never be found, and Indiana and his dad go off to experience a new relationship and living happily ever after. Isn't that a picture of the relationship with Jesus? There's so many Christians, we want to hang on to Jesus with one hand, but with our other hand, we're reaching for everything that the world says we have to have in order to be happy. Oh, if only I can be financially secure. If only I can still be a big name in the community. If only I can still have the good, successful career. If only I can still have the happy family where there's just peace in my home and we're not divided over dumb theological issues. I want it all. Everything the world has to offer, give me that, and I want to hang on to you. And Jesus' call is, hey, look at me. Let it go. Grab onto me with both hands. I won't let you fall. I'm not going to say you're going to get all that stuff. You might just plummet into that bottomless pit and you'll never see it again. But you'll have a relationship with me. We'll ride off into that sunset. You won't need anything else. What is our message that we're sharing? That God's desperate for people to hear? They got to know if they're going to be saved. They got to know who Jesus is. They got to understand who they are. But that's not enough. It's not some intellectual test that they take. They have to make the decision. All right, Jesus, I believe you. I'm willing to follow you. And I want to grow in learning how to trust you completely. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm not sure I understand why you put such a heavy message in our hands and called us to be the one to share it. But I'm grateful. I'm grateful to be a part of it because it does give me such joy whenever you use me to be a part of somebody else's eternity. God, I pray that we take this message, that we not resent it because it can be divisive and it can be hard. I pray that we embrace it because it's beautiful. It's true. It's saving. I pray, God, that you help it grow in us so deeply, so bountifully, that it just kind of spills out of our mouth every time we turn around, that you're just everything we want to talk about, everything that we get excited about, everything that we think about, able to leave the other stuff behind, clinging on to you so that we can experience the joy of our salvation, but then we also know how to share it with others. We love you, Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for loving us first. In Jesus' name, amen.